to this date, we have had a magnificent Lent. We have been exposed to many new concepts, I hope, and some old ones, things like temptation and prayer and the enemies and adversaries that we have as Christians and how to follow the leader, Jesus. But today, we're going to speak of and address punishment and grace. Both are contained in the collect for this day. Now, we admit in that collect that we deserve to be punished. Can you believe that? Yes, we do. We admit it. We pray what we believe, and we believe what we pray. So we deserve to be punished, and we understand that. And that's because ours is a hedonistic age. Temptations are innumerable. We're on the next step. There's a temptation. And so we understand that we deserve to be punished because we oftentimes slip up and do things we ought not to do. Now, denominations, and it used to be in the good old days, all the Christian denominations knew precisely what the teaching of the faith was. But now some remain faithful, to be sure, but other denominations have chewed the apple a little bit of sin in the world and the devil, and have erred and strayed from the ways of the gospel message. Allowing then sin and heresy to enter into the fold. If you wonder what those gatherings of Christians are, you'll see it if you have a bad turn in life and attend one of those masses, one of those Sunday services. I don't understand how that happened, other than the fact that, you know, with each generation that we have new people who come into the church, and sometimes the teachers of the church, the bishops, priests, and deacons, don't teach. And so if you don't tell people what's going on, they'll manufacture what they want. And I think that is some of it. But the church's mission really is essentially quite simple. It is clear. It is to teach and preach and live and share the faith, to save people, that's called salvation, so that man can be healed and fed and made whole. Now, life in this world at this time, and I think it's probably always been this way, there is a simple dichotomy. The church on one hand and the world on the other hand. The church heals people. That's our calling. We change sinners into saints. The world, on the other hand, disrupts the church and changes saints into sinners. At least they would like that to happen. Now, that's a thing that we have to deal with time and again and with each generation, because new people come in. We old folks finally get a chance to be in the presence of God. Beulah Land is beckoning us, and then the new people come in. But it is a timeless, and every decade or so, we fight the good fight. It's a never-ending struggle. Luther put it this way. He said, where God builds a church, the devil builds a chapel. It's true. So the fight is never-ending. Never-ending struggle until his coming again, and then it ends. So what is the enemy, really, that we're dealing with in this life? Well, if you want to have a list of them, I suppose you could use the seven deadly sins. But I'll tell you, all of those seven deadly sins, in one variation or other, of it is pride. Pride's the father of all sin. Here's really the enemy as far as we are concerned individually. It is the inclination that we have to do what we want to do rather than what God would have us do. Therefore, and it is in a kind of peculiar way, we punish ourselves, don't we? Well, that's a bad thing to have happen. Is there a way out? Is there a cure? Is there an antidote or a vaccine for this? Yes. It's grace. God's grace. That's the second thing we pray for this day. That by the comfort of God's grace, we may be relieved from the things that we have to deal with in this life. What is grace? It is the holy, the presence of God, the holy making the unholy holy. It is the hand of God sanctifying His creation, all of creation. Let me give you an example from the gospel narrative. 5,000 people were in the presence of Christ. People were hungry. There wasn't any food. God intervened. Folk were fed. Jesus made something out of nothing. The grace of God was in that presence. What is our grace? Well, corporately here in this church, in this small little magnificently beautiful St. Luke's Church, our grace has to do with the founding of our parish years ago. We couldn't have done it without grace, God's presence. Our grace is the securing of the land. We bought the land in 1 year and paid it off the next. We have God's grace shining brightly with the building of this magnificent little church. The steadfastness of parishioners, even to this day, and our survival through extraordinarily difficult times shouts God's grace and presence within this community. And so that's corporately for St. Luke's Church. We hear then of what happened in the gospel narrative today. But then let's expand the understanding of God's grace also. Resurrection. That's what we anticipate in a few weeks. What does that mean? Victory over death. That's God's grace. And then faith, hope, and love. He gives us grace so that we can have faith and hope when we need it here, and then love eternal in the beatific vision of Almighty God in the end of time. Those are exemplars of God's grace in our midst, and we all will have or will also experience those things. Now, left to our own devices, man cannot succeed. We can't do it. We are but earthen pots, cracked, leaky, parched, some wrinkled too. So, yet we come to know in this place, we come to know that nothing will stop His word from being proclaimed, from being preached, received, shared, lived, and embraced. Nothing can stop the word of God from drawing human beings to Him, except ourselves, when we say, "Thou shalt not." And yet we come to know the holiness and the grace-filled presence of St. Luke's Church and of the fellowship that we have here in this church. Now, let me, since I have already addressed it a little bit, I want to talk about the courtyard. You know, if you have a history of St. Luke's Church, you know what the church looked like before after the first Mass. The courtyard was kind of rustic, I'd call it, you know. It was all barren, virgin ground. But through passage of time, we've cleaned it up, moved things around. We've done some things that really made the place look much more beautiful. And that comes from raking and, you know, pulling the weeds, doing that manual labor, trimming and removing dead evergreens. And the grounds, I must say, are getting prettier and prettier as our days increase. I'm not talking about the grounds. It's an allegory, a parable of our Christian walk. A spiritual examination that we need to do to get rid of the trash, the stuff that makes it impossible to live as God's child. There's a lot of that stuff in our life, and we just need to clean it up and get it out. Things will get better, and so will we. By taking out the useless and removing the excess. That's what Lent is about. Now, is punishment inevitable? No. God's grace takes care of that. God's grace is sufficient. For we shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. Instead of the thorn shall come up the fir tree. Instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree. When God's grace is given and received, we grow and are enabled to do all things for God's greater glory.